Morning, brothers. How y'all doing this morning? I want to talk to you this morning. First of all, I want to come and thank you for your prayers. Maybe a lot of you don't know what you prayed for me for, but last Thanksgiving, right before Thanksgiving, I started feeling, going back in a sense of depression. And I thought it would be okay, so I went to the doctor, and he upped my medicine for me. And that didn't seem, well, it done pretty good. And then I went on it, rocked along. I had a real good birthday. The day of my birthday was December the 8th. Me and the wife went out and really felt good that day. And then Christmas, that was really good. And then Valentine's was good. And right after that, I seemed to crash and burn. And what it was, I went into a real severe depression. I was in it 21 years ago, but it was more of a milder case, I believe. But anyway, I got so bad in February that I was kind of out of it. Matter of fact, I wasn't at Band of Brothers from, I believe it was from that part of February until, I'm trying to think when it was now. I believe it was August, September, probably sometime around about September of this year. You prayed for me, and I'm going to tell you, I was near a point in my life that I did not want to live, but I was too scared to die. I was trying to think of ways that maybe I could get out of here, but I knew my family. You know, when you do that, when you do something to yourself, you affect your family, very much so. And so anyway, y'all's prayers, the people's prayers and calling and stuff is, it just meant the world to me. Just meant the absolute world. And I wanted to come here and thank you. Don't ever take prayer lightly. I'm going to tell you something about prayer. David Jeremiah, 20-something years ago, told me, and I never forgot it, or not personally, but told me. He said, and when you think about it, prayer takes the least amount of effort of any person. But that's the most powerful tool that you have. To talk to God. It's just talking to God. It's just talking to God. That's all it is. My clarion call was so bad one time. I sat out in the backyard, and I sat in a chair, and I didn't move for 5 hours. I just was looking at the ground. My wife went through this too. I'll tell you, when I look back at her, she was a godsend. She went through this. She didn't go through the depression, but she couldn't leave me because she didn't know what I was capable of doing. She had to make me take a bath, had to make me eat, had to make me go with her. She'd take me. She said, we're going to the grocery store. I said, no, I'm not. She said, oh, yeah, you need to go and get out. I walk around in the grocery store. And I want to tell you this in all reality. Richard, you brought up a good point. There's two kinds of depression. Remember, I never did tell but one. There's what they call chemical depression, which is a serotonin level, what the scientists call it. I don't know what God calls it, but that's what the sign. And then there's situational depression. Sometimes people, I've had friends that are in a situation to where they're in a bad situation and they have been depressed. And then when that situation maybe eases, then you kind of come out of that. And if you've not been there, you really don't know what I'm talking about. But it can happen to anybody. Matter of fact, the psychiatrist that I talked to, I asked him, I was sitting there, I said, have you ever been in depression? He said, no. I said, well, you don't know where I'm at, do you? He said, well, I can tell you this. He said, I'll give you an analogy, and it's about like you being in quicksand up to your neck, and you doing everything you can to stay up. And I said, well, that's a good analogy. It's about the same one I had. But honest to goodness, brothers, I was completely out of my body. If you can, I don't know how I can explain it to you, but I was. I was just existing. I was not living. But the prayers of these people.
Amen. God is good.
You'll never know what that means to me. Let me tell you something. Jesus Christ was the exemplifier on prayer. Amen. Think about it. How much he prayed. Think about it. I think when he went in the Garden of Gethsemane, he said, we're his disciples, and he asked us, could you not pray with me for 1 hour? My clarion call, and it's right now, is all I could say was, God help me. God heal me. I bet you I said it 45,000 times a day. God help me. God help me. God heal me. But I had people that came to my rescue through prayer, through love. You don't know what you guys mean to me when I look at every one of you. You'll never know what you mean to me. You'll never know. You ain't got a clue. I know. And the littlest thing that you do for somebody, you think it's nothing, but it means everything to that person that's being done. Hadn't somebody done a little something for you, and it just meant everything to you? I know. I love you, but right now, I hadn't taken him because I'm going to eat, but I called this here. I got a pill that I take. That's my Jesus pill. He's the one that made these. Scientists, who made the scientists? Who created the world? Who created everything? Yeah, everything points right back to Jesus Christ. This right here can be a good thing. I want to ask you something. Let me turn this on. What when you see that, what does that remind you of?
Money.
No, what does that the forbidden fruit in the Garden of Eden. Think about that for a minute. This right here is what can be a wonderful tool in ruining many lives. A 20-year-old boy, let me tell you something, Mom, right now, and this is really helping me. I'm still in the ministry, but I'm working at Fox and Wheat Funeral Home, but I don't want y'all to come see me, okay? I'd rather you not do that. If you come see me, I want you to see you outside of that. But I'm doing there part-time, and I was with a 20-year-old that's working there, one of the owner's grandson. He said, Mr. Billy, he said, let me tell you something. He said, this cell phone right here is what one part is ruining our whole generation. Think about it. He said, I'm in a generation that we don't even know what sex we are or want to be. Well, Kenny said something about the list of things. Well, I tell you, I got an answer. I didn't tell Kenny, but I'm going to tell him. But I got an answer for that. What sex are you? I'm what God made me. That's what I am. And I'm a man and you a woman. And that's all there is. There's nothing else to go to. Now, talking about prayer, I want to share something with you. I want to read this to you because you never know. I want to tell you something Kenny told me also, too. If you allow me to, I want to read this from a brother that James Rudy LaMonica, I just people after people, came by my house, took me out, took me to do things with me, and I was just out of it. I didn't want to do, but they loved me enough to come take me. So right now, thanks be to God that I'm 1,000% better than where I was. 1,000%. I hope I can get through this, guys. It's not long, but before I get into the Bible, I want to set the stage here with this, but I want to share something with you. Brother Billy, it was great to spend time with you and James this morning. This was about a month ago. I don't know if you'll ever appreciate how much of a positive impact you have on the people around you. You are a powerful witness, a wonderful example, and the best friend a person could ever ask for. It's no wonder that you had an army of people praying for you. Everyone that knows you loves you. We are also grateful that you have recovered and back to doing God's work. It is who you are. I love you, Brother Billy. That touched my heart. Now, let me tell you something. Y'all know Kenny Grant. Who? You know Kenny Grant. Yesterday he was talking about, I was worked the funeral. We did John Davis's funeral yesterday. And it was funny. He was talking about getting these pecan muffins, and he said, I'll wrestle you over them pecan muffins even if I have to get black and blue. He said, I'm already black, so I guess I'll just turn blue. But anyway, going through this, Kenny said something to me. I got to tell him, explain him about this depression. He said, Billy, it was right here. He said, I don't want to hear any more about it. I can't handle it. I said, come on. I said, no, I really don't want you to tell me about it. I've got into the intrigue like I'm telling you about it. He said, I don't want you to tell me about it. I said, all right. Then later on, he told me, he says, when I saw you and your wife in Arby's sometime back, and I knew you were like that, he said, it has affected my ministry. He said, I couldn't be all that I wanted to be because I knew something was wrong with you. Let me tell you something, people. You guys have got an impact on me like that. When I see you out and about, you'll never know I'm nothing. How can I have an impact on Kenny Grant, you know? But you just never know what you mean to people. You'll never know. People come and put their hands on you and pray for you. That's powerful as you can get. Right, Roland Dan? You can't beat when somebody goes to pray for you there. Judge you, I'm going to tell you something. You need the prayers and I need the practice. Pray. I don't know if any of y'all know Dan Coe. I want to share this with you before I get into the Bible. He's my next-door neighbor. He was the assistant executive director at the airport. He and his wife was on Chatham Parkway about 5, 6, 7 years ago. They stopped on the parkway to help somebody. You remember? She got killed. He almost died. Matter of fact, Dr. Hardigan told my wife when she worked with him, said, I don't think either one of them is going to live. Dan made it. He's got brain damage, but he's still a go-getter. I mean, he's an old Marine, so, you know, he tells you that. He tells me that, but he's out in the yard and got his leg all strapped. Well, the point I want to make is he was in the hospital for 3 months, and he didn't even know he was alive. He didn't know his wife was dead. I kept going up there because he was my neighbor, and I worked at the airport, and his mother says he can't see you. He wouldn't know you. So about 3 months went by, and I went up there again, and he was alert. He was awake, sitting up on the bed. So when I walked in the room, his mother said, Dan, here's a friend of yours. You know him? That's what I'm telling you, the impact that you have. It ain't me. Here's what he said. He said, I don't know his name, but I know that man's got a burning fire in his heart for the Lord Jesus Christ. That broke me over like a double-barrel shotgun. He saw Jesus in me. And that's what we want to see in each other. That's what we want to see. You want to see the Jesus in the person. I'm going to ask you something. Are you ready? Will somebody be kind enough to get me a little bit of water? Bring me a little cup of water if you can. Thank you. Are you ready? Howard, he's coming. You got it on your shirt. Are you looking up? Are you? I'm going to ask you guys, are you ready? Or seriously, are you ready? Not getting ready. Not hope so, think so, want so. I plan to so. Are you ready? I appreciate that, Brother David. God bless you. I'll drink a cold water in Jesus' name. Anyway, thank you. Well, let's have a good time right here. Let me tell you this one. Myrtle and Alice was two ladies. They grew up together. They hadn't seen each other in about 30 or 40 years. So Alice said, Myrtle, how you been doing? Are you still married to Tom the banker? Said, no, he died. No kidding. She said, yeah. Then I married Fred, a movie producer, and he lived about 5 years, and he died. And then I married a preacher. John and I was together about 20 years, and he died. Now, thankfully, I'm married again. She said, you've been married 4 times? She said, yeah, I've been married 4 times. But they all died. She said, my God, well, who are you married to now? She said, I'm married to Frank, the undertaker. She said, you mean to tell me you've been married to a banker, a Hollywood producer, a a pastor and a funeral home director. She said, yeah. So what's all that about? She said, well, one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready, and four to go. So, so if you turn with me in your Bibles to a precious book that I love and you love, and the First John, we're going to have a First John in your Bible, chapter 2. How about let's have a little, everybody wants to, let's go back to school and have a little easy test. This is going to be an open book test. But it's not really so much of a test, but it is about where we're at. And this is a 7 questions, if we can get through them. What time are we looking at? Oh, I think we'll make it. About knowing and growing in your relationship with God. Brothers, we can't give away what we don't possess. If you don't have Jesus Christ, you cannot give him away. You can't walk the walk and talk the talk and all that there. You got to have that Spirit of God living in you so other people will know that you're authentic and you truly have a relationship with Jesus Christ. We know right from wrong, don't we? You know when you think wrong, when you say wrong, the things come in. You can't control what comes into your head, but they come. Crazy things. First, there's a thought. You don't know where that thought comes from. Then there's a feeling that comes after that thought. And then after that, there comes an action. What you going to do with that thought? Is it right? Is it pleasing to God? Is it acceptable before God? Let's look in chapter 2 of the book of 1 John. John the Beloved. Let's start out here at actually chapter 2, and we'll start at verse 1. Now, what does the Bible tell us about coming as a little child? That's how we must approach. And we are children. We are God's children. I want to make sure of one thing. I've had preachers do this, and I'm not going to try to trap you, but how many of y'all believe that everybody on the face of this earth is a child of God? Everybody believe that? Well, let me tell you something. You're wrong. Ain't no way. Let me explain that. Here's what the Bible says. This ain't biblical. Let's be biblical. Let me tell you what the Bible says. You are a created being made in God's image and then after his likeness. But you got to receive Jesus Christ to be his child. You have to be adopted. Remember Nicodemus? I call him Nick at night. He came at nighttime, so I believe he came at night. My feeling is I think he came at night so he could have a private audience with him. So he could really get down to the brass tack. But Jesus told him, you must be born again. And the only way to be born again is when you receive Christ Jesus as your Lord. Then you are adopted and you are a child to as many, the Bible says, to as many as receive him, to them become the children of God. Those that are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. So the minute you ask Jesus to forgive your sins and to be your Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit lives in you right then. Okay. My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, which we all are sinners, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. Now, not to say that we're not all intelligent, but that word propitiation, I wanted to look that up so I've got several different meanings. But what it boils down to is that $20 word is he is the perfect, Jesus is the perfect sacrifice to reconcile us between us and God. In other words, God, Jesus, and us to sin. And Jesus is that reconciles us. He's that perfect sacrifice to pay for our sins, okay? Now, here we go. The test of knowing him. Now, by this we know that we know him. Let me repeat. Now, by this we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. You say you want to know God, there you go. I was just that simple. He who says, I know him, and does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him. He who abides, he who says he abides in him ought also to walk just as he walked. Now, this is going to sound like a play on words, and I did some in-depth studying on this, and some of you fellows in here as pastors, you do too. But anyway, it doesn't sound like he's just, in other words, kind of repeating and changing himself. But he says right here in verse 7, brethren, I write no new commandment to you, but an old commandment which you've heard from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you heard from the beginning. Now, what that's saying is that if you go back, the greatest commandment, the greatest commandment is what? Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second one is likened to it is what? Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law of the prophets hang on those two commandments. So how can we truly say, and this will say here, how can we say we love God if we hate our brother? And we'll get into that. All right, let's look at verse 8. Now, 7. Brethren, I write no new commandment to you, but an old commandment which you've heard from the beginning, And again, a new commandment I write to you, which is in true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. Now, let me tell you something. The old commandment was given back when with Moses, but Jesus is the living part, the new part. Jesus is that new commandment that we see. He's, in other words, that commandment of love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, strength, love your neighbor. That Jesus is living proof of that. In other words, when you see him, you see the light of him. When you see Jesus Christ, that's what you see, that light in him. You see that that is a new from him, because Jesus is a new every fresh every morning. So when we see him, we see that commandment of loving God and loving our brothers. Amen? Amen? All right. Okay. He who says he is in the light hates his brothers in the darkness until now. He who loves his brother abides in the light. There is no cause for stumbling. But he who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. That can be complex. I'm thinking about something. Hate is a four-letter word. But you know what it is? Well, the Holy Spirit will show you that you love that person, but you hate if what they're doing or saying, right? Right. Now, if they're not doing according to God's word, then you don't like what they do, what they're doing, but the person is always still that hope. I know my own family. I don't know about some of y'all, but when God, when I became a Christian, not a preacher, I forget that, but when I started living for God and the Spirit of God started living in me, some of my family almost, they just annihilated themselves because the world is not running sync with a Christian. It just doesn't do it. Don't you see it out there? It just doesn't run that way. Let's look at the spiritual state right here in verse 12. I write to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven, you for his name's sake. Now, this is to fathers. I write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. Do you know him? Do you know him? But more than know him, do you have him? Do you have him? I write to young men. There's young men in here. There's old men in here. So he's talking to us. I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. All right, how about our children? I write to you, children, because you have known the Father. I have written to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. It's up to us fathers and us Christians to be that example, to be that light to these that are in the world that we come across. It's easy, to me, it's, I don't know about you, but it's easy to witness if you think about it. Every time you see a stranger, they go, you've heard me say this before, they're going to ask, how you doing? Fine, how you? Fine, both of you lying. We ain't fine. They, not one of us in here is not dysfunctional. But I'll tell you what make the difference. People ask me right now, say, Billy, I know you've been sick, but how are you feeling right now? I said, let me tell you something. If Jesus was any better than me right now, I'd be triplets. But I said, my wife can't stand one of them. She ain't going to let two more in the house. But anyway, as far as that goes. Or either if Jesus was any better to me, I'd be doing a backflip, and then you'd have to call EMS if I could do that. But the point being is, if you give God the glory and the credit, you know, for everything, because you know good and well, none of us in here, you didn't ask to come here, did you? You had nothing to do with that. You didn't choose your mother and father, did you? You didn't choose where you were born, did you? How about the color of your skin? Did you choose that? You didn't choose nothing. The color of your eyes, hair, you didn't choose none of that. Well, I mean, it makes sense that there's a creation, that we're created beings, right? I mean, to me, it's a no-brainer. Let's look at this. He says here, when I flip the page on 14, verse 40, I have written to you, young men, because you are strong, and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. I like to look out here, and I see some young men out here right now, some of you young men that like that 20-year-old that was with me in the car, riding with me, that loves the Lord, and boy, that gives me hope. I wish I would have done that, Richard, back instead of, I was running anything but that way, but that young man impressed me upon me as his relationship with the Lord. Two or three of them. And that's, well, you young men that's in here, you walk in the light of the word. You know, you speak to God when you pray. God speaks to you when you open this word. If you want to hear what God has to say, I'm telling you. Last night, while Sandra was watching television, I said, I'm going to go ahead and do a little brushing up on this. I don't read nothing, but I can't get out of this. I get in this role, and I just got to stay in it. I mean, there's nuggets that's happening, and when you find one, then you're going to go to another, and you're just going to keep building and building and building and building on it. Let's look at this. Here's the part now, at verse 15. This is very prevalent right now. And it says in verse 15, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. Let's look at those three passages a minute. First of all, if we go back, we saw that apple. There's the three things that Adam and Eve did right there. Right there before us, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. It could be out wherever you eat. That you'll be like God. There was that pride that came in. This world's passing away, people. It's deteriorating. Let me tell you something. I get so sick of this climate. Yeah, the climate's changing, but we ain't got nothing to do with the climate changing. That's a joke. That's a pure joke. But if you want to do something there, just pick up trash. Keep the trash out of things and not, you know, you can, there's things you can do. You know, I look at the American Indian. He didn't. Remember that? Did y'all ever see that commercial with the one in the canoe with the tears riding down there when he was in the canoe that time, at a time when he saw the trash in America? Because it wasn't like that. But far as changing this climate, there's nothing on this earth that don't come from this earth. God created everything. This medicine in my pocket, this shirt on my back, you. I'll tell you what, working in the funeral home business, when you see a dead body, it's a different thing now. Boy, I look at, from the preacher side of it, I look at it one way, but when I look at a body now, you know what, that's not you. The you is your spirit and your soul that's in you. That's what's in you. When that's gone, that body, I mean, it's true. It goes back to the back. I mean, believe me, I've been there since August, and I've been around enough of them that it's just amazing. Really, I can look at it now and say, well, that person truly, when they say he's gone, they gone. They have left. They have left the building. They left the tent. Amen. They have left. And so get a perspective on who that is. I mean, you know, we can look, but you look at the quality of the inside of a person, and I want you, and I want to see Jesus in you, and I hope, God, you'll see Jesus in me. It's a struggle. It's hard. It's really a struggle. It's a daily struggle to let him live through you. But the only way you're going to do it is when you're in here. Sin is going to keep you from this book, or this book is going to keep you from sin.
Amen.
This is God speaking to us right now. See, we know that the world's passing away. We know that. Little children, verse 18, is the last hour. And this just about is the last hour. We're just getting one. As you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know that there's the last hour. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. They went out that they might be made known that none of them were of us. But you, everyone in his building, every one of us is believers right now. Listen to this. You have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things. I've not written to you because you do not know the truth, but because you know it, and there is no lie in the truth. Who is the liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? He is an antichrist. So what you want to know who an antichrist? Anybody that doesn't believe in Christ, that doesn't accept his birth, life, death, and resurrection. Tommy, I see you brought my buddy with you, didn't you?
Amen.
Whoever denies the Son does not have the Father either. He who acknowledges the Son has the Father. As the Son has the Father also. So I'm going to put a... I've got a lot more ammunition, but time has run out. And you know what? It's always good, and I know... I was talking with Kenny. You do a lot more preparation than you really have time to, and you want to be that, because I could stay here and unload on you, but I'm not going to, because you got to go to work. But before I close, I can't thank the band of brothers enough. I didn't even realize until where I was at the importance of how people and them truly praying and caring for you. Let me tell you something. God hears the prayers of the faithful. Listen, believe this. When you leave here, if nothing else, the prayers of a righteous man availeth much. Live righteously, and that's just living right by God's word, and God will guide you. He will bless you. He will answer your prayer. God doesn't hear the prayer of a sinner. I mean, if a sinner crying out, but I mean, if you living and practicing sin, please get out of it. You broke your relationship. You are living with a broken relationship. He'll love you no matter what, but I tell you what, when you striving to obey his commands, right from wrong, and give it him, I guarantee your life will be different. You will walk, you will feel good inside. The Spirit will give you that life and light and guidance. So walk and be led by the Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, my prayer right now for every man in this room, Lord, I want to thank you for putting each one of these in my life. In each one of our lives, we look at each other, Lord, as one, iron sharpens iron, so one of us as we sharpen each other. Lord, we need each other. We need you more than anything, Lord, but I just thank you for each one of these men. I just pray that, Lord God, that today, as we're getting ready to leave here at 7:30, that we will have moved closer in our dependence, in our thanksgiving, our trust, and our faith in you, Lord, that you will be the light, the Lord of our lives and in our lives, that everything that we do, everything that we say will be pleasing in your sight, and that we put on the mind of you. When we go to have a thought, a choice, an action, Lord, that we know that what we do is pleasing in your sight. And Lord, when we do that, we walk in the light of your ways, and our brothers and sisters see that, and we pray for them that we can reach out and encourage others to come to the truth and to be saved. In Jesus' name, amen.
Whole again, we praise you for your mercy.